It's all yours, Hugh.
Okay, well, good morning, everybody. It is fantastic to be with you. And let me just start with a thank you to the team here for inviting me to do this. I was sharing with the guys, this is actually the first time I've ever been asked to speak on music and theology and all of life and so on, and it's something I've always been interested in, I've been thinking of doing, but I've never had an invitation to do this. So I'm really honored that you have invited me and that you've given up your time to come and be here this week. So thank you so much. I really appreciate it. I'm really humbled. I've thoroughly enjoyed my preparation for these sessions. What I should say is I'm so excited about this that I might just fall over into, you know, kind of vomiting on you all. Not literally, but you know, musically, verbally vomiting on you all. So if at any stage you find me speaking too fast or going, I hope I will go off script, but if I do and I get technical.
Slipping into Welsh.
Slipping into, that shouldn't happen. That would be quite miraculous if I do manage well. But yeah, just to say, at any stage you need me to apply the brakes and say, well, hold on, maybe you've lost me, or you're just, I'm really cool with you saying, sorry, don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, I'm conscious I didn't introduce you properly.
Ah, okay. Yep.
Are you going to do that yourself, or do I go to you?
We
first met you 96?
96, yeah.
96, when you had just come to Glasgow to do masters in conducting.
Yes.
Yeah. And we ended up at the same church and got to know you a bit then. And just our paths have sort of bumped into each other a few times over the years, but more in the last probably 5 years actually.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you want to say just a wee bit about your history now?
Sure. Yeah. So as Mark mentioned, I was studying conducting. I'd already got a music degree at that stage in 96. I studied postgraduate conducting. From 1998, then I was able to turn professional. So for 13 years, I worked as a professional conductor, working with orchestras and opera companies and various musical projects. And that took me through to 2011, when I had a career change and became a missionary. And 2011, I moved with Alison, my wife, to Italy, to Turin, where I pastored the International Church of Torino for 8 years. And that brings us up until last summer, which was when we moved to Ireland. So we are now, just for the last few months, we've been living in Greystones, just south of Dublin, and I'm pastoring another church there, Hillside Evangelical Church. So that's my career. Alison, I've already mentioned, we were married in 2001, where our two daughters came along when we were living in Italy. So Kitty is now 7, Clara is 5. So they speak fluent Italian. They're now learning Irish. And they have my heart. You know, they are the loves of my life, my wife and my kids. So yeah, that's a bit about the family. Is that all right?
It's great.
Okay.
You know, in contrast to me, always it's nasty. You're such a nice man.
Well, I would have to contest that. I really know. I'm very kind of you to say.
Thank you, Hugh. It's fantastic to have you here. And I think the subject we're tackling this week as well, it seems to me amazing you've never been asked to do this before, given your professional expertise and just how important a subject it is, and the implications of it all, and what that the kind of tools that can give us as well. So,
sure.
Thank you for giving up your time.
It's an absolute joy, and I mean it. It's a real privilege. Anyway, let's crack on, shall we? So, I don't want to call this a disclaimer, and it's certainly not an apology, but I feel as though I have to be very clear from the outset of this week that what I am endeavouring, trying to do over the course of these sessions this week is very unfashionable. And by unfashionable, I mean academically unfashionable. I spent 15 years in academic environments, firstly as a student, then as a postgraduate student, and then later as a lecturer and a teacher. And I can't think of a British or American academic institution that wouldn't be rather bemused by what I'm trying to do this week. So there's a dilemma right at the outset. Why listen to me rather than a large majority of academic opinion that I hope to just push back against this week? It's true that there are much smarter people than me on the other side, at least if you limit the view to the last 30 or 40 years of academic thought. But if we consider the whole corpus of academic opinion of history, as if that were possible, but imagine it, then the proportions change dramatically, and I don't look quite so far out on a limb. You don't have to go back that far in history to find a time when many people of my expertise, my area of work, would have taken what I'm proposing to you this week as quite acceptable, if not patently obvious. So then I must just be an old-fashioned conservative, is the obvious conclusion, isn't it? Well, I don't believe I am. I don't believe I'm old-fashioned or conservative in the true sense, but you can be judges of that if you wish. And I don't intend to spend any time showing how the jump to that conclusion that I'm a conservative is largely intended to just dismiss and shut down a conversation, and that's really quite problematic for healthy academic discourse. You can see I've had this conversation before with people. But what I would ask you to keep in mind as we go through this week is whether or not we should embrace this idea. And this is put about widely and largely unchallenged, that the latest ideas are by definition the best ideas. The academy, and by the academy I mean your further education in general, particularly higher education, thrives on this notion that the latest ideas are necessarily the best. And it's understandable, isn't it? Research is to a large extent discovery, and new academic ideas and discoveries are very, very welcome. And they're often exciting and wonderful. And at the same time, the uncritical, unquestioning embrace of historical ideas can be just as dangerous. But there is there a straight upward line of progress in human thought? Are the good ideas of history always displaced by the better ideas of contemporary thought? In our search for the new and for the undiscovered, are we in danger of throwing the historical baby out with the bathwater? Or are we better off without the old water, the old baby, and the old bath? And better off just taking a nice cleansing contemporary shower? That's all by way of just saying, that's a really posh way of basically saying, please hear me out, okay? I'm convinced that what I'm saying this week is hugely important. And I really do pray, and I have been praying that you'll find it helpful. And I'm trying to cover a lot of ground, so it might be a bit sketchy in places. And as Mark said, please just bear in mind, I am available. I would be more than happy in any of our downtime to get a coffee, have a chat, to explain or expand, or even to, for you to say, actually, I think you're talking cobblers, you know. I'm more than happy to have that conversation. I hope I'm not prickly about that kind of thing. Let's start with something maybe a little bit unexpected. Here we are today, the problem with growing up. Kenneth Graham. Anyone know the book that Kenneth Graham is famous for?
Wind in the Willows.
Wind in the Willows, yeah. Wonderful. We're not doing any Wind in the Willows, sadly, this week, but Kenneth Graham also wrote two charming books of childhood reminiscences, the first of which is called The Golden Age. Has anybody read The Golden Age? You're in for a treat already. Get The Golden Age. This book opens with a portrait of the adults who brought the young Kenneth Graham and his siblings up in the absence of their parents. He never explains where his parents are, interestingly. But anyway, these adults are termed the Olympians. They're only ever referred to as the Olympians, these grown-ups, as the children called the grown-ups. And they were aunts and uncles who, Graham says, treated us indeed with kindness enough as to the needs of the flesh, but after that with an indifference as I recognize, the result of a certain stupidity. And therewith the commonplace conviction that your child is merely animal. At a very early age, I remember realizing in quite impersonal and kindly way the existence of that stupidity and its tremendous influence in the world. A little later on in the same chapter, he goes on to say, these elders, our betters by trick of chance, commanded no respect, but only a certain blend of envy of their good luck and pity for their inability to make use of it. Indeed, it was one of the most hopeless features in their character when we troubled ourselves to waste on them, which wasn't often, that having absolute license to indulge in the pleasures of life, they could get no good of it. They might dabble in the pond all day, hunt the chickens, climb trees in the most uncompromising Sunday clothes. They were free to issue forth by gunpowder in the full eye of the sun, free to fire cannons and explode mines on the lawn. Yet they never did any one of these things. No irresistible energy hailed them to church or Sundays, yet they went there regularly of their own accord, though they betrayed no greater delight in the experience than ourselves. And the chapter ends with this short paragraph. Well, the Olympians are all past and gone. Somehow the sun does not seem to shine so brightly as it used. The trackless meadows of old time have shrunk and dwindled away to a few poor acres. A saddening doubt, a dull suspicion creeps over me. Et in Arcadia ego. I certainly did once inhabit Arcady. Can it be I too have become an Olympian? It's a powerful piece of writing. And it reminds us that there can be a big problem with growing up. Priorities and values.
Yeah, Arcady and Olympia for folks to.
Yeah.
Do you want to expand?
Yes, Arcady is, of course, the natural world. Typically, we might
say, of course,
Arcadian. We might say Arcadian, you know, sort of reference to the woods, the natural world, you know, the beautiful landscape and so on. Olympus was, of course, the place where the gods lived in Greek mythology, Mount Olympus and so on. So the reference to the Olympian and the strong ones, the powerful ones, the people in charge and so on. Are you happy with that?
As opposed to enjoying the natural world.
Right,
like growing out of that.
Exactly, yeah. So, we got that. So, those are the Olympians, and of course, in the Latin quote there, I also am in Arcady, I am also inhabiting the natural world. And it's a powerful piece of writing, this Kenneth Graham piece. It reminds us that there can be a big problem with growing up. Priorities and values change as we get older, and not always for the better, is what Graham's saying, isn't it? We can increase in years and strength and wealth and influence in the world, and yet forget the most valuable things we learned in childhood. Life meant something different to the young Kenneth and his sibling. Nature meant something different to them as children. The world had a different meaning to them before they grew up. Can it be I too have become an Olympian? You get that sense of the tragedy of what Graham is feeling. Now, none of us wants to say childish forever, but there's great value in remaining childlike. There's a difference between being childish and being childlike. Unless we forget. Remember what Jesus said in Matthew 18, 3-5. Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. Sorry, I've used a different translation there, but you've got, that's a ESV I've read. And so we need to learn to be like little children. I still do sometimes work with grown-ups who are like little children. Not necessarily in the sense of Jesus means. They are childish. And I think, come on, grow up. But there's also that sense in which we are to remain like little children. We are to remain childlike with a humility, with an openness, with a lack of cynicism. My kids believe anything I tell them, you know? They're 5 and 7, that will soon change, I know. But right now, whatever I tell them, they think is true, and I can have great fun winding them up with all kinds of nonsense, you know, and then I have to tell them, oh yeah, I was just teasing. But it's a beautiful posture that they have, that childlike posture. If someone tells me something, it's probably true. Well, we don't want to be naive, but neither do we want to be cynical. We don't want to be cynical Olympians. We want to be open to what the Lord is saying. We need to learn to be like little children. Jesus is telling us this. As we learn to see God and see life in his world. With humility, willingness to learn, to be taught, with an open-mindedness and a lack of skepticism. And sadly that often comes with our education and our life experiences. So may God help us. That's by way of introduction. We're here this week to think about music, meaning, and myth. Now in this session this morning, we'll begin, I hope, with the first of those two elements, music and meaning. I hope there'll be plenty of myth thrown into the mix as the week goes on. But the starting point for our discussions right now is this question. Can music mean anything? While you ponder that question, let me play you an extract from a piece of music. You might recognize this, I don't know. Do I need to click this again?
Yeah.
Thank you. Is that one going straight on your top of your playlist on your phone? Like, I don't know. What did you hear in that music? And you know, I'm not going to kind of judge you for any answers here. I just want to know any sort of just first responses. And it's okay to say that was the worst thing I've ever heard in my life, or that's the best thing I've heard in my life, or something in between. Or just how did that make you feel? What did you hear? What did colours? Maybe you see colours. We can talk about that another time. Just any response. What did you think? What were you feeling? What were you hearing about?
Violence.
That's exactly my word.
Okay. Right. Yeah. So this is visceral. Yeah.
Definitely felt senses of relief, like when
they're
quiet or pieces.
Right. Yeah. I mean, your ears are banging, aren't they? It's about, my goodness, at least we got some. Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Huge amount of rhythm.
Yeah.
Different repetitive rhythms, but then changing gradually in sequence.
Right.
And then
yes.
The flute at the end was kind of almost a bit of a sense of humor at the end.
Right. Yes. It feels like that. Yes. It just feels very similar. Yeah. Yeah. Good. Good.
Yeah, it did feel a bit dissonant because it's obviously a serious piece, but of something about it that was making me slightly smirk. I think it is because it's quite fantastic.
Yeah.
I'm expecting the reveal of a deadly villain.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. I don't know if it's because maybe it's or music I've heard parodied a lot, and so I almost imagine like I see a very pathetic, dastardly figure.
Okay.
Creeping up.
Okay. Right, good. That's a, yeah.
And then fear.
Right.
And maybe that's partly because of the subject matter, but yeah. You know, there's this sort of violence and this discord. And something that feels almost out of control, but you realize, in fact, there's something perhaps darker pushing the thing.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah,
I'm not going to listen to that sort of a quiet romantic evening.
No, it's definitely. Yeah, the evening might end up with getting hit in the head to fright. And
I kind of got that too. I kind of got fight or flight vibes. Like,
right, yeah.
On one hand, sort of like fighting or something,
yeah.
And on the other hand, some other people would be like staying back from it.
Right, right. Yeah, yeah. Did you just feel yourself thinking, I want this to end? Yeah. Yeah, there's something. Yeah, I mean, in a good way, you know, you kind of. I hope you could enjoy it to an extent, but also, this is. You know, I'm thinking of a movie like the Saving Private Ryan. Have you ever seen that movie? You know, that opening sort of 15 minutes. It seems to go on for 2 hours. I remember sitting in the cinema, and these guys are just piling onto the beaches, you know, the Normandy landings. And I'm just thinking, I want this to end. This is horrendous. But of course, this happened. And so I don't want this to end because I want to feel this, because all those people went through this, you know. And so we can have that tension sometimes of, I want this to end, but I don't want this to end. You know? Well, that music, as you can see there, it was the end of the Rite of Spring. It's the famous dance sacral by Igor Stravinsky. If you don't know the story, what was actually going on there was at the end of of the Rite of Spring, it's a ballet, and a young girl is chosen. This is pre-Christian Russia, so this is pagan Russia. A girl is chosen, and it's all very pagan. It's all to do with the adoration of the earth and earth worship. Pantheism. young girl is chosen from the village, and in the dance of crowds, she literally dances herself to death. And so that's what's been depicted there, and what have been danced there. So you can see how a lot of your responses were very, very near the mark. And if you didn't know the story, you know, that's very telling, I think. The Rite of Spring is widely considered to be the most significant piece of art, music in the 20th century. That's not an overstatement. Most people would agree with that. This piece is considered so important that as a young undergraduate composition student, I was in university, my very first composition tutorial class, we were told if we had not listened to the Rite of Spring at least once, we were to leave the class and not bother coming back until we had. And I can understand that. I don't have a problem with that. I'm relieved to say I had heard it once, so I could actually stay in the class. The fact is it's very, very difficult to overstate the importance of this piece of music and of its composer, Igor Stravinsky, in any discussion of 20th century art music. The Rite of Spring, as I mentioned, is a ballet, and its first performance in May 1913 in Paris, the audience rioted at what they were both seeing and what they were hearing, what they were seeing on the stage, what they were hearing in the orchestral pit. And this was an incident, this riot at the first performance, certainly helped to catapult the young Stravinsky, just shy of his 31st birthday. This is a young man, really shot into fame, international fame, as if that incredible score we've heard wasn't enough to do that. Of course, a riot at the first performance is a great way to get attention. Now, Stravinsky went on from 1913 to dominate the musical landscape of Europe and America, even beyond his death in 1971. His influence in music would be at least equivalent to figures such as Picasso in visual arts, a figure like T.S. Eliot in poetry. Think of how influential they are in their respective fields. Stravinsky would be at least equivalent, if not more so, in music. To this day, first-rate composers, I mean, I've had conversations with brilliant composers today who still speak of Stravinsky as this presence. You know, looking over their shoulder as they write. You know, they tell me, yeah, I've burned hours of my own music because, you know, I've composed and then I've realized, oh, I've fallen into pastiche. I've just started, you know, writing bad Stravinsky, you know. You mentioned, you know, I've heard this before. It's become so much part of the language. You were right on the money with that comment. That this, you know, has become something that people can't escape from, this musical language. But when it comes to this question of music and meaning, remember I asked you, can music mean anything? Here is what this colossus of a figure, Igor Stravinsky, said on this subject. Now, what do you think of this quote? I consider, this is on the brochure, so you may well have already read this. I consider that music is, by its very nature, essentially powerless to express anything at all, whether a feeling, an attitude of mind, or psychological mood, a phenomenon of nature, etc. Expression has never been an inherent property of music. That is by no means the purpose of its existence. Later in the same book, Stravinsky makes the same point in this way. Most people like music because it gives them certain emotions, such as joy, grief, sadness, an image of nature, a subject for daydreams, or still better, oblivion from everyday life. They want a drug, dope. Music would not be worth much if it were reduced to such an end. When people have learned to love music for itself, when they listen with other ears, their enjoyment will be a far higher and more potent order, and they will be able to judge it on a higher plane and realize its intrinsic value. Notice those words very carefully. Now, depending on how you were feeling when we listened to the close of the Rite of Spring there, those statements may or may not surprise you. Do you find that surprising? the dates are significant. Notice, Stravinsky wrote this in his autobiography in 1935. The Rite of Spring was premiered in 1913. 22 years have passed since that first, that riot, the first performance of The Rite of Spring, and the publication of Stravinsky's autobiography in 1935. Whatever else is going on here, and whatever else is what we're going on in what we heard earlier, to the phrases, music is by its very nature essentially powerless to mean anything at all. And phrases such as, expression has never been an inherent property of music. Do those statements actually ring true? Remember, this is the same person who wrote The Rite of Spring who's saying this. This is a rhetorical question now, but does that ring true? Let's listen to another piece of music by Stravinsky. This one is from the 1930s. This one is from nearer to the time he wrote his autobiography. And this is his violin concerto in D. See what you make of this one. More in keeping those words with those words from Stravinsky, that music is, than the earlier example. I love that very much. I love that music I just played, but I would struggle to say what it was expressing. I love the colours, the different combinations, the orchestration. Stravinsky is playing around with colour in remarkable ways. It's vibrant. It's so exciting. It's a marvellous celebration of sound for its own sake. You might remember, you know, Stravinsky talking about sound for its intrinsic value. Even the title of that piece is deliberately abstract. Did you notice? Violin concerto in D. It is what it is. Yeah. As opposed to, or as compared with, rather, 1913, The Rite of Spring, Pictures of Pagan Russia in Two Parts. You can even see the difference in the titles, never mind the sound. It seems as though something has happened to the music of Stravinsky in the two decades or so following 1913. And that thing is that, in the minds of Stravinsky and others who thought like him, music had grown up. And so had we as human beings, in their view, in the way we think about life, and art, and in our case, music. Stravinsky had forged forward with musical modernism. The question is, if music has grown up, has music to become an Olympian? Let's talk about modernism for a while, a musical modernism. According to most commentators, modernism was a philosophical movement originating at the end of the 19th century and was to a large degree a reaction against the old ways of looking at the world, and in particular the high ideals, the big gestures, the expressivity of Romanticism, and we'll look at Romanticism later in the week, which dominated the philosophical and artistic landscape of the 19th century. When you think about it, some of you might know your history a lot better than I do. I'm sure you do. But Europe went through huge social and economic and technological change with the Age of Revolutions in the 19th century, not least the Industrial Revolution. And many people, not just artists, found themselves feeling very much out of tune with the old ways of looking at the world, particularly with the turn of the century, and soon after, especially by the end of the First World War, with all its horrors. Hence, modernism emerged out of Romanticism. Historically, music, this is a key point now, historically, music has always been a follower of the other arts. Painting, literature, and so on have been quicker to adapt to philosophy than music has. And so, as Picasso, T.S. Eliot, and others were already breaking new ground, with modernist styles of painting, modernist styles of literature, music was, true to form, was still asking what these ideas might sound like. In architecture, the international style would become vogue eventually, characterized by some of those buildings we still see today, your rectilinear forms, use of glass, steel, reinforced concrete. Now artists reveled in the enjoyment of a line for its inherent quality as a line, a rectangle for its inherent quality as a rectangle, and so Stravinsky and other musical modernists began to present new sounds simply for their inherent qualities as sounds and nothing more. So for modern artists, the line is a line. Sorry, modernist artists, I should say. The line is a line. A rectangle is a rectangle. The sound is a sound. But here's the thing, it means nothing more than that. It represents nothing else. And crucially, it cannot. Hence we get Stravinsky's comments there. In literature, writers such as James Joyce, you might know, or Dylan Thomas, my countryman, began to experiment with radical new uses of words. Not using words in a conventional sense, but now having their own immediate meanings as sounds, rather than understanding them in the context of a sentence, and, you know, conventional grammar. Whatever else was going on with modernism, this is a huge subject. The thing we need to grasp for our purposes this week is the death of meaning. Artists felt unburdened. Well, I hope we'll see why when we look at Romanticism later in the week. I just felt unburdened, liberated from the high-minded ideals of the 19th century, Romanticism. and they were unburdened by just this very simple idea that an object, an image, a sound, even a word, has no inherent meaning. It is what it is. Enjoy it for what it is. But it is, and can be, no more than its physical substance. Here in the visual arts, especially, the popular term became abstract. Used to hearing that word in art gallery, don't we? Abstract. Non-representational. So the blocks of colour you might see on a modernist canvas represent nothing else. It's not a portrait, it's not a landscape, it doesn't represent a feeling, it represents nothing other. Those blocks of colour are what they are, and we are invited to enjoy them for what they are, in the abstract. So maybe it's no wonder that Christian thinkers like C.S. Lewis, like J.R.R. Tolkien, and other thinkers of their ilk saw the philosophy behind all of this as the big rupture in Western human thought. They saw the advent of modernism as a far bigger break in human philosophy than both the Reformation and the Enlightenment, although they were well aware, of course, of the connections between all of these. Tolkien summed up this period by calling it the age of machines. The mechanized, the impersonal, the dehumanizing world of modernism, increasingly separated from nature, from beauty, and myth. Mm-hmm. And our love affair with machines is clearly far from over, is it? He says, reading off his new iPad. Hans Ruckmacher, looking back much later on in his famous book, identified this period of modernism as the death of culture. And this begins to explain Stravinsky's words we saw earlier, as well as the differences we heard in his music, his own music, over a couple of decades. In saying what he said in 1935, Stravinsky was actually distancing himself from that musical language with which he wrote The Rite of Spring, in favour of a philosophy of music which represents nothing, which means nothing. Music has grown up, and music has left home with modernism. And I hope this helps to explain at least where we are today. If that last couple of paragraphs, last couple of minutes was a bit heavy going for you, that's the heavy bit over, I hope. I hope this will be a little more familiar. Where are we today? And what are the implications? What are the outworkings of modernism, specifically for us this week, as we think about music and we think about meaning? Well, the first is obvious. If music has no meaning, and if music is incapable of carrying meaning, then the rest of what I have to say this week is essentially a waste of time. But much more seriously, if things have no inherent meaning or value, we have to rethink our approach to aesthetics, the examination of beauty, taste, and so on. Now, as was often the case, C.S. Lewis saw the natural outworking of this a lot quicker and a lot more lucidly than most people. A little book called The Abolition of Man, Lewis wrote this, and he sees in this book, he picks up a seemingly harmless grammar school textbook. Has everybody read The Abolition of Man? Just in case I'm preaching to the choir here. Some, yeah, okay. So just to let you know what's going on if you haven't read it. Lewis has been sent a copy of a grammar school textbook, and he sees in the thesis of this book, and it seems harmless enough, but actually he sees great danger in it, because he sees some of the awful implications of modernism coming into the education system. So the school book tells its young readers of a famous case of Coleridge at the waterfall, and Coleridge observes two other people who are looking at this waterfall, and one person describes it as divine. The second person describes it as pretty. Now, Coleridge affirms the first, you know, the divine, and he despises the second, the pretty. Come on, this is a waterfall, this is awesome, you know. The school book says, though, that both descriptions are actually nonsense. Because a waterfall is actually neither. Yeah, the waterfall's just a waterfall. It's not divine, it's not pretty. Somebody else might look at it and say, oh, that's horrible. Yeah. It's just a waterfall. And what the school book is saying is that the waterfall is simply a waterfall, incapable of possessing meaning or value in and of itself. Whatever things we feel when we see it are merely projections in ourselves, from ourselves. And Lewis, of course, with typical brilliance, sees the horrendous implications of following this through to its logical conclusions with a terrifying and a brilliantly accurate prediction of where this will lead. You know, Lewis is really predicting where we are today. Now, today the West is largely held by postmodernism. I'm sure you've heard that word. Some observers, people like Timothy Keller, prefer not to call it postmodernism just yet. They prefer the phrase late modernism because they don't think we've left modernism behind just yet. And I tend to agree with that. Not that I'm an expert on postmodernism and so on, but I tend to agree. I'm not sure we've left modernism behind entirely. If there's a big difference between Stravinsky and where we are today with music, I think he probably turns on a greater emphasis on that personal response. Music still has no meaning in an absolute sense, but we may add a personal meaning to it, which is true to us. What this means to me is, and so on. And that's just as valid as everyone else's personal meaning. Multiple truths can operate simultaneously because truth is in the interpreter, in the case of music, in the listener, not in the object, not in the music itself. Can we track it? Yep. So if we return to the academy, what does this mean? And I only talk about the academy because usually the ideas we have in the academy filter down to popular culture and our own daily experience. What are the current trends of thought? Well, they're showing themselves very clearly. When I was teaching in university context, I had a fellow lecturer. In fact, he taught me, and then, you know, when I went to work there, he became a colleague. He would proudly tell his students that he had not listened to a piece of music by Handel in 25 years. All of his research, all of his top courses, all of his supervision were in popular music. They were in studies in Madonna, in Radiohead, in punk, and so on. Now, I'm not saying that to criticize or anything. I'm just saying 20 years previously, this would have been unthinkable in a respected academic institution because the opinion, the climate would have been Handel would have been considered objectively better than Madonna and thus more worthy of research grants. You can argue about that yourself. Now, however, such value judgments are not recognized. You see, we're not allowed to say, well, who are we to say that Handel is better than Madonna? More people like Madonna than Handel, and so on. You see, the modernism or the late modernism is working its way through because the music doesn't have its own inherent value anymore. Neither the music of Handel nor Madonna has inherent meaning or inherent value. So attempts at comparison are futile and old-fashioned. Value judgments are entirely personal, subjective, and thus irrelevant, and that's important. And so the old distinctions now between high art and low art are demolished. You know, high art, you know, I'm thinking of painting, I'm thinking of, you know, classical music and poetry and so on, low art, the more popular forms. Those distinctions completely disappear now. You cannot have high art and low art if art itself has no inherent meaning or value. So those distinctions are demolished. Duke Ellington famously commented, there are only two kinds of music, the good music and the other kind. Yeah. And that's become a mantra now. You can see the attraction of it because beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Same with literature. I know some of you at least have been or are literature students, so you know better than me, about the struggle with this question of, is there meaning in the text? Yeah, I've seen some people nodding. With many late modernists, in the answer to that is to find an answer in critical theory, yeah, which replaces the old values of aesthetics takes them away and examines a text or other work of art through the lens of a particular critical theory. So it's the same with music. With the new musicology, what's known as the new musicology, we can now study music through the lens of gender, sexuality, ethnicity, and so on and so on, without looking for any inherent value or meaning within the work itself. We judge it through the lens of our own standpoint, looking back. Arts Academy, maybe you have no interest in becoming music students, and that's fine. But we're going to see this, and we already are seeing this filtering down into everyday life. Think of television. Arts programming has changed dramatically since I was a kid, and I don't think I'm that old. Not yet, anyway. In fact, arts programming has been slashed during my lifetime. Let me ask you this, when did you last see a new production of a Shakespeare play commissioned and aired on mainstream television? Or an opera? When I was a kid, you know, there'd be a new Shakespeare production every 2 or 3 years on the telly, and my mum would make me watch them, and I was bored off my head because I didn't like Shakespeare then, but I can remember it because my mum used to make me watch them. But then you see the idea. Why should the BBC or any other broadcaster that are available, why should they be commissioning productions of Shakespeare plays when Strictly Come Dancing is much more popular? There was a time when value judgments were made about Shakespeare and Strictly Come Dancing, according to the belief that one may be more enriching than the other, but the old aesthetics don't apply anymore. But we need to come closer to home again. How about in our churches? Over the centuries, churches have been patrons of the arts. Countless masterpieces of visual art, music, and other artworks have been commissioned and funded by the church from the conviction that it would be valuable. It would be beneficial to have this artwork created and accessible to people. Today there are notable exceptions. I don't want to say everybody has lost the plot here, but there is a trend, I think, towards the Shakespearean, particularly in the evangelical tradition, we have to admit. Many churches are now opting to buy in their worship music and even their visuals in a one-size-fits-all package. Why should we look for another Johann Sebastian Bach in our congregation when we can sing the same songs as the big church in the city with well-known worship? Can it be that we Christians also feel just as suspicious and wary about making value statements or value judgments? Now I'm really trying very hard not to be judgmental in presenting all of this. I'm simply trying to observe trends as objectively as I can. And laying our own personal preferences aside for a moment, we have to challenge ourselves that we to ask some searching questions. Are these trends real? Or are they my caricatures? Because if there's any truth of them, are they indicating progression or regression? Like I said earlier, are the new ideas just replacing, you know, better? Are they just better ideas replacing inferior old ideas? If I can encourage you to make a value judgment of your own, can I ask if this is a good thing or a bad thing? Because maybe none of this is a bad thing. I have to face up to that possibility, don't I? Maybe I simply am a conservative, a victim of middle-aged longing for the good old days, which never existed. And that is a danger of middle age, I'm observing this. Maybe we are more civilized, and maybe we are more civilized now than at any point in human history. Maybe we are. How do we engage this with a Christian mind? We do well to begin at the beginning. Let's read Genesis 1, if I can get our PowerPoint back. Let's read Genesis 1. I don't read the whole chapter because we've listened a lot to what men and women think. We've listened a lot to what I think, but let's just I'm going to read the whole chapter if you don't mind, I'll show you. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters. And God made the expanse and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so. And God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening and there was morning the second. And God said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit, in which is their seed, each according to its kind on the earth. And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kind, the trees bearing fruit, in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning the third day. And God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. And God set them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning the fourth day. And God said, let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures, let birds fly above the earth, across the expanse of the heavens. So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that with which the waters swarm according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful, and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening, and there was morning the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds. And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. And God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of all the earth. And every tree with seed in its fruit, you shall give them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. There's so much to see, isn't there? In Genesis 1, and it's really ground zero account of God's creativity. But perhaps what's most pertinent for our discussion this morning is that word that occurs seven times, verses 4, 10, 12, 18, 21, 25, 31, and God saw that it was good. Do you see what's going on here? God is making a value statement, and repeatedly so. It's not that it made God feel good. The goodness here is not something that God, as the interpretive community, has projected onto matter that is neither good nor bad. God saw that it was good, inherently good. His creation possessed goodness in and of itself because he made it. Now the first and the seventh observations of God about the goodness of creation in verse 4 and then in verse 31 are put slightly differently. Did you notice? Verse 4 says, God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. It seems as though the light, as separate and distinct from the darkness, is good. This is a statement of relative value here. God saw that the light was good, but there is no mention of God seeing that the darkness was good. And then related to this in verse 31, we have another statement of relative value. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. The whole of God's creation now, in its entirety, including now man and woman in his image, is very good. And the value statements don't stop there, because if we went on to chapter 2 and verse 18, we would read God saying, it is not good for the man to be alone. If we take nothing else away from Genesis 1 this morning, let's take this, that God's word right at the very beginning is at odds with the modernist reading of aesthetics. A thing can be good, something can be very good, something else can not be good. A thing can possess inherent goodness and value. It does not have to be reduced to simply a thing, devoid of meaning and value. This is underlined by Jesus in Matthew 6. A briefer reading this time. Matthew 6, 25. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body or what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They don't labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If this is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Jesus is making value statements here. Statements of relative value. It's not that the birds of the air or the flowers of the field are unimportant. This is not a license to be environmentally reckless. But Jesus is saying that we are more important than the birds of the air, the flowers of the field, and so on. God clothes them, feeds them. They are part of the goodness that God observed in Genesis 1. But Jesus' point here is that we are more valuable than they are. Now, we've got a lot more work to do on this week. But this is a start to our theological thinking with this principle. And if this is one thing you take away, it is okay to think of things as having their own beauty, their own value, their own meaning, and of greater and lesser values in relation to one another. God himself does so. Now, we might not find this easy. We might find this idea deeply uncomfortable. This may go against the grain of so much of what we have been taught. This can be very, very uncomfortable to think about. And we certainly, I know I don't, I certainly don't always get this right, and I don't always do this in the right manner, but the answer to the particular problem is not reductionism. It's not to strip everything of its meaning and value and to reduce it to the bare bones of its material properties. That will only be to produce, as Lewis puts it, men and women, we might add, without chests, without hearts, without feelings, without... Music has grown up, music has left home, and maybe we as humanity have grown up and left home too. The question is music thriving? Are we thriving as human beings? Or are we at sea with no home to rest in?
the prodigal needs to return. Can it be that I too have become an Olympian? I don't need to think, I mean, I'm basically at the end of the session now, I don't need to think that everything that modernists ever made is bad and evil and to be avoided. Okay? And have we got 15 minutes to listen to a piece of music?
So we can have a toilet break first.
We can have a toilet break, we can stretch legs, and then it, or we can make this optional. We have coffee in about 25 minutes, don't we? So there's a very short symphony by Prokofiev. It's going to take 15, 16 minutes to play. And I would love to play it to you in a positive sense, to give you a sense of, you know, this music can be great to listen to if we know what it is we're listening to. So.
Should we take a micro break?
A micro break?
Yeah. Two minutes?
I'm going to start it in.
I could certainly do that.
Right.
I will just pause the recording.
Yep.
Whilst we do that break.
Perfect.
Toilet, can you upstairs landing? Front door toilet.